presentations is, today we are celebrating the International Day for the Conservation of the Mangrove Ecosystems, which is celebrated worldwide. This is the first program from Puducherry NMU Center. We are collaboratively working with APTRI Hyderabad, Environmental Protection Training Research Institutes, for this webinar. Okay, sir. I'm just giving to senior scientific officer to give his welcome address.
Happy morning to all of you. It gives me immense pleasure in welcoming all the people who are at this platform today on the eve of International Day for the Conservation of the Mangrove Ecosystem, which is the first of its kind jointly organized by NVSUB, Puducherry Pollution Control Committee, Environment Protection Training and Research Institute, Hyderabad. We all know that a mangrove ecosystem is unique. It's a special and it's a vulnerable ecosystem. I take this pleasure in welcoming Sri Adar Shinwa, IAS, Director General of EPTRI and Special Chief Secretary to Government of Telangana, sir, for sparing your valuable time and also kindly accepted to release awareness poster at the end of the webinar. I welcome you, sir. I take the honor of welcoming our Director and Member Secretary of Puducherry Pollution Control Committee, Sri Dinesh Kannan IFS, sir, who have made his presence to grace the occasion for your opening remarks. I welcome you, sir. It's my privilege in welcoming the today's speaker, Sri Joju P. Alapet. Sir is National Award winner for Forestry Research and presently working as Director, Science and Technology, and also Member Secretary for Andaman and Nicobar Pollution Control Committee. Sir, we thank you profoundly for accepting our invitation immediately and for being with us to deliver this August lecture today on this today webinar. I would also like to welcome all the officials of the department, EPTRI officials, Puducherry NVSUB team members, and all participants from diversified backgrounds who have joined today and being with us. This webinar will certainly raise awareness in the minds of the participants on the importance of mangrove conservation. I now request our Director and Member Secretary, Puducherry Pollution Control Committee, sir, for your opening remarks. Thank you.
Thank you. Good morning, everyone. We are extremely sorry for the delay due to the technical problem. Today is 26th January. This is the International Day for the Conservation of the Mangrove Ecosystem. Since 2015, UNESCO had adopted this day to commemorate the conservation of mangrove ecosystem with the aim to create awareness on the importance of mangrove. The interface between the marine and terrestrial ecosystem. We can say on the other way that mangroves are the tidal forest. They are the special type of the vegetation also. In the present times, mangrove forests occupy more than 2 lakh square kilometer area across 30 tropical countries. It is 1% of the total forest in the world as on date. There exist over 100 species of mangrove plants, creating a rich ecosystem and protects the coastline from storm surge, filters out pollutants, and they are home to over 174 species of marine megafauna that includes oyster, shrimp, sponges, barangles, etc. In India, we have 4,921 square kilometer of mangrove forest, with the Sundarban in West Bengal being the largest mangrove cover in India. Also, I can say that the second largest mangroves in Tamil Nadu, that is the Pichavaram mangrove forest. Apart from Pichavaram mangrove forest, we do have mangroves in Bitargeniga, one of the famous turtle nesting site in Odisha, and Koringa mangrove forest along the Godavari Krishna River, and Ratnagiri mangroves in Maharashtra. They are to name few among the mangrove in our country. Even with a small geographical area, the Union Territory of Puducherry has a significant mangrove cover along the stretches of Ariyankuppam, Chunnamba River in Puducherry region, and a significant cover at Arasalar backwater at Karaikal. But at present, mangroves across the globe are under threat due to the climate change, human exploitation, pollution, etc. According to Global Mangrove Alliance, an estimated 67% of mangroves have been lost or degraded to date, and an additional 1% is lost annually. Also, mangroves are disappearing 3 to 5 times faster than the global forest losses. Therefore, the present situation of mangrove ecosystem demands efforts from different stakeholders of every sector, including awareness on mangrove ecosystem for the general public. With the aim, the Puducherry Envis Hub has brought this webinar in order to raise and spread awareness on the need to conserve the mangrove ecosystem and promote innovative solutions for the sustainable management and conservation. Also, I extend my sincere thanks to Sri Adar Sinha, IAS, Director General, EPTRI, and Special Chief Secretary to Government of Telangana for their support for today's program. Thank you.
Today, on behalf of us, an eminent speaker, Joju P. Alapat, who is appointed by the UPSC as an Assistant Conservator Forest in the Department of Environment and Forest. He is also trained from Central Academy of State Forest Service at Dehradun during the period 2004-06 and served as an Assistant Conservator of Forests in various divisions of Forest Department of Andaman Nicobar. Presently working as a Director, Andaman Nicobar Island Forest Training Institutes, South Andaman, and a Director, BSTE, Andaman Nicobar Administration, and a Member Secretary, Andaman Nicobar Pollution Control Committee. He has received a Lieutenant Governor's Commendium Certificates for his meritorious achievements in the field of biodiversity conservation, research, and education in the year 2015. And he's also received an ISFRE Forestry Research Award under Awards of Excellence in the Forestry in the year 2019 by Indian Council for Forestry Research and Education, Ministry of Environment, Forest, and Climate Change. To honoring his contributions in floristic studies of the islands, a new species of plant discovered from North Andaman Island by a team of researchers from University of Calicut was named after him, Opioriza jojui. Thank you, sir. Thank you for being as an expertise in these mangrove. So now we can start the presentation, sir.
So good morning to everybody. First of all, sorry for the delay, technical issues. Anyway, the problem could be rectified right now. So we will start a small presentation on mangroves, especially on the subject as a unique, special, and vulnerable ecosystem. As all of you know, global importance and attention after 2004 tsunami and the havoc many of the Indian Ocean islands, especially Andaman Nicobar Islands, as far as India is concerned. And from that time onwards, the attention by the local public as well as the government agencies has increased many fold, and many plantation drives were taken up for vegetating the barren coastal areas of the country with the mangrove species. And today, on the occasion of observing the international mangrove ecosystem, we will have a detailed presentation on the mangroves in general and with a special reference to our country. As you all know, these mangroves are a unique group of plants which form a critical interface between terrestrial estuarine for ecosystems in tropical and subtropical regions. As far as an ecosystem is concerned, the mangrove present both floristic as well as faunal elements. They are growing in a very stressed condition. Stress, there is social stress with respect to the habitat where these mangrove plants are seen. The coral is often considered as a vulnerable or an endangered ecosystem because of some of the unique features of the and species thriving in that areas. Some of the unique features of this ecosystem and the mangrove species as well is low species diversity, simple strand structure, sonate vegetation, and fragile habitats. Floristic elements in the mangroves are concerned. There are both vascular as well as non-vascular plants that are higher plants as well as lower group of plants are there. In the lower group of plants, algae, fungi, mosses are often met with in mangrove areas. Plants besides mangroves, associates, which are also an integral part of the mangrove ecosystem. Many of the orchids are seen in mangrove ecosystem because of the unique features of the habitat. As for aquatic, semi-aquatic, and terrestrial communities in the mangrove ecosystem, the major group of animals representing mammals, birds, reptiles, amphibians, and fishes, polychaetes, arthropods, and meiofauna. If we go to the technicalities of the mangroves, first of all, regarding the name mangroves derived from the Portuguese word of mango and the Spanish word mangal, and combining with the English word grove. The habit is concerned, they are, and some species are bushes, usually growing between high spring tide and mean sea level. Morphologically, mangroves are more or less similar to xerophyte plants because though they are growing in a water environment, availability of fresh water is very less. Most of the features which are common with the xerophyte plants. General classification of mangroves are concerned. Mangroves are generally classified into two as well as mangrove associates. The true mangroves are those species which can thrive only in mangrove habitats, whereas mangrove associates are those species which can come in non-mangrove areas also. And as far as the habitat is concerned, a variety of substrata supports mangrove vegetation, like silty and clayey muds, calcareous muds, or a mixture of all these things. And as far as the global distribution is concerned, they are seen tropical and subtropical regions only. No mangroves are represented in the temperate region. They are seen between 32 degrees north and 38 degrees south. Extensively, they are represented in the both east and west coast as well as Andaman Nicobar Islands. They generally prefer creeks, bays, estuaries, well protected from high waves and strong winds, usually within the tidal reach. As far as the global diversity is concerned, we say that their number ranges from 70 to 80 species. Depending upon the ranges, because there are a lot of confusion with respect to the proper identity of mangrove associates and true mangroves. Some scientists, as far as the species are concerned, some of the species are included in the true mangroves and vice versa. So we cannot give an exact number for the true mangrove species. Rather, we can give a range that is from 70 to 80 species. And as far as India is concerned, we have 46 species of true mangroves. Now, if you go to the adaptations, since I have already told mangroves show xerophytic characters, they are thriving in a very stressed environment. First of all, there is unavailability of fresh water, clay, and the area is very susceptible for high tides and winds. So in order to overcome all these limiting factors, mangroves develop certain adaptations. This adaptation starts from root system, then it is there in the leaves, in the fruits, and also in the germination of seeds. So viviparous germination is a peculiar feature of the true mangrove species. Some species show C4 type of photosynthesis also. And as far as the utilization is concerned, provide food, medicine, shelter, and tools. And they are the breeding grounds for shellfishes, prawns, and other marine species. The major impacts and threats with respect to mangrove ecosystem is mostly pollution, oil spills and sewage, those for most of the development activities, species extinction in some of the species, then agriculture and prawn culture, leveling of or reclamation of mangrove areas for cultivation, deforestation, development of ports, industrial units, etc. Generally, help in coastal protection as acting as barriers against devastating tropical storms and waves. They are a good breeding ground for marine species, especially fishes, prawns, etc. And as far as the conservation is concerned, there are marine national parks and sanctuaries has been declared for the conservation of mangroves. Biosphere reserve, that is Sundarban Biosphere Reserve, is also helps for protection of the marine ecosystem of the country. And as far as the laws are concerned, there is coastal regulation zone notified under Environmental Protection Act 1986 for the conservation of mangrove areas. The regeneration of mangroves are mostly natural. We can go for assisted regeneration also. Nurseries also can be developed in difficult areas for the propagation of the species. If you go through the adaptations, the first type of adaptations are seen in root system. They have specialized stilt roots for giving additional support for the plant as it is mostly thriving in a very clayey soil. They have also prop root system for giving additional supports, knee roots for breathing purpose, buttress roots for mechanical support, for gaseous exchange. And the morphology of nematophores are also varied from species to species. In some species, the nematophores are pencil shaped, conical shaped, and in some species, it is peg like or flattened just like a ribbon. Leaves are also very thick, coated, and they show a lot of water, and they have special mechanism for reducing transpiration. Fruits are mostly viviparous germination. In some species, there is cryptoviviparity also. If the physical adaptations are concerned, pollution and salt excretion is C4 type of mechanism in some species. Salt tolerance is also varying from species to species. Some species are thriving in high salinity areas, some in the low salinity, and some are in the medium salinity areas. As far as the global diversity I have told, we can 69 to 80 species according to different authors. And as far as the countries with the maximum number of species, Indonesia ranks first with 50 species of true mangroves reported, followed by Australia. India has about 46 true mangrove species, Thailand, Philippines, Singapore, and China. The major families of mangrove species are Rhizophoraceae, Abyssiniaceae, Acanthaceae, Mediaceae, and Sonaraceae. In a global perspective, The mangroves are distributed over 123 countries and territories in the tropical and subtropical region. Their total cover is 150,000 square kilometer, which forms 1% of the tropical forest of the world. Asia has the largest area under world's mangrove. The most extensive area of mangrove is found in Southeast Asia, followed by North America. South Asia comprises 10,344 square kilometers of mangroves, which forms 6.8% of the total world mangrove cover. Indian contribution for the total mangrove cover in South Asia is 45%. And as we are concerned about the distribution in Asia, the Indo-Malayan group has the highest species diversity in the mangrove species, in which the Indian subgroup, Burma Indo-Malaysian group, and Northern Australia are the major mangrove-rich areas. The highest species diversity has been reported from Indo-Burma-Malayan group. In India, the total mangrove cover is 4,975 square kilometer, which forms 3.3% of the total world mangrove cover and 0.15% of the total geographical area of the country. The major zones of mangrove distribution in the country are West Coast, that is Malabar Coast, Gulf Kutch, and Gulf of Kambar. Then Maharashtra, Ratnagiri, and Mumbai, Goa, Karnataka, Kerala, and Lakshadweep Islands. The most of the mangroves are distributed over Coromandel Coast and Sundarbans in the states of Tamil Nadu, Andhra Pradesh. And as far as the coastal protection of the country, are waiting for the mangroves, starting from reduction in freshwater flow, marine and coastal pollution, siltation, sedimentation, and excessive salinity. Out of the 46 species of true mangroves of the country, 9 species have been categorized as globally threatened. They are belonging to critically endangered, and vulnerable categories. As far as the area is concerned, as I have already told, West Bengal ranks first with 2,112 square kilometer, followed by Gujarat, 1,177 square kilometer. Andaman Nicobar Islands has 616 square kilometer of mangrove cover, followed by Andhra Pradesh, Maharashtra, and Odisha. And the species diversity is concerned, Andaman Nicobar Islands ranks first with 38 species of true mangroves, followed by Odisha with 35 species and West Bengal with 33 species. Puducherry has 15 species and Tamil Nadu has 17 species. As far as mangroves of Andaman Nicobar Islands are concerned, I told you that this is the maximum richest assemblage of mangrove species are seen in Andaman Nicobar Islands, density as well as species diversity. The mangroves of Andaman Nicobar Islands are the most diverse in the whole of the country, and their species richness is also very high. Out of the 46 species of true mangroves reported from the country, Andaman Nicobar Islands. Uniqueness of mangroves of Andaman Nicobar Island, the third largest country, as far as diversity and richness is concerned, they are the number one. Andaman Nicobar Islands, the major part of mangroves are seen in Andaman group with the 614 square kilometer, where Nicobar group has only 2 square kilometer. Before tsunami, Nicobar group represented about of mangroves, but during tsunami, stretches of Nicobar were lost. Now it has been restricted to only 2 square kilometer. A total of 46 species of mangroves has been reported from the country. This is the list of 48 species of mangroves. Among these 46 species, 42 species are the true mangrove species and 4 species are hybrids. Now, if you go to the impacts and threats of mangroves, there are both biotic as well as abiotic factors are there. The abiotic factors which threaten the mangrove ecosystems are mostly cyclones, earthquake, tsunami, etc. And from the biotic side, habitat destruction, loss of biodiversity, habitat loss and species extinction, encroachment, change in the zonation pattern, uncontrolled siltation and weed infestation in some of the area, formation of mangroves for petrochemical and other industries, spills, uncontrolled fisheries, grazing, etc. To the mangroves, with the true mangroves, we can see some of the species which are non-exclusive species. They are generally seen associated with the mangroves in non-mangrove areas also. So these species are generally categorized as mangrove associates. Important species are Barringtonia, Dolichandron, Fungamia, Exicaria, Terminalia, etc. And in the shrubs, the most important species are Hibiscus tiliaceus, Pandanus pleurodendron species, Acrosticum, etc. And number of climates are also seen in the mangrove habitats like Duris, Scandens, Cisalpinia species, etc. The mangroves generally occur in communities. Important communities of the mangroves are Rhizophora communities, then Rhizophora Brugyera communities, Avicennia communities, Exicaria agalocha, Nepa Acanthus community, Pandanus community, etc. Coming to the conservation and management aspects, for the conservation of mangroves, marine national parks has been created in the country. Biosphere reserve has been declared. World natural heritage sites are there. Then community reserves and conservation reserves are also there. Wildlife sanctuaries also has been declared for the conservation of mangrove ecosystem. One important aspect of Indian mangrove is most of the mangroves of the country are not covered under Indian Forest Act because they are away from the notified forest areas. They are mostly revenue occupied or so in order to protect this unique ecosystem, people's initiatives, NGOs are very much required with the government's policy and laws. The Government of India has launched National Mangroves Conservation and Management Scheme. And emphasis has been given in the National Environment Policy for the conservation of mangroves. And in the Coastal Regulation Zone of 1991, specific guidelines has been given for the protection of the mangrove ecosystem. If we summarize the effect of the mangroves, we can broadly classify the utilization into ecological importance, economic importance, and social importance. As far as the ecological importance is concerned, the most important aspect of mangrove is stabilization of coastal stretches and beaches. They act as natural barriers against sea intrusion. They are the shelter bed against devastating cyclones, carbon sink. At the same time, they are also habitat for many life forms. They play a great role in the food chain. They are the feeding and breeding ground for a number of marine species. And also they provide habitat for wildlife ranging from migratory birds to estuarine species like crocodiles, tigers, etc. Now coming to economic importance, they provide timber, non-timber forest produce and minor forest produce, fisheries and agriculture, a number of species are used as food and medicines. Then coming to social importance, some of the mangrove species are worshipped by the coastal people. Of mangroves after tsunami has been witnessed by the country, and lot of mangrove afforestation programs has been started in the country. I am not going to the details of planting in naturally rich. We can directly go for planting of the propagules of the mangroves, but in the disturbed areas we will have to make the nursery, and the nursery seedlings has to be planted in the areas. And there are certain points for remembering plantation. The plantation or the selection of species is the most important aspect once we go for plantation. It may vary according to the objective of planting, site, salinity, tidal amplitude, and light condition. Different species has varying light demands. Their tolerance towards tidal amplitude is also different. Some species can thrive in very high saline areas, but some species are very sensitive to salinity. The soil conditions also play an important role in which areas, that we have to see. Species selection is very important as far as the site is concerned. We have to select the species according to the site, especially the soil conditions. Method, as I have already told, in the undisturbed areas, we can go for direct planting of the propagules of the mangroves. Generally, high density plantations are undertaken in mangrove areas. There is no separate period for planting. It can be planted at any point of time. Mixed plantation is often encouraged for a number of reasons, and maintenance is also very important. Now, as far as the 2004 tsunami is concerned, a lot of mangrove areas of the country was affected by mangroves. Upliftment of landmass was observed in many areas. Many areas were permanently inundated. In Andaman Nicobar Islands, the northern group of islands were uplifted for about 1 meter. So that the mangrove structures could not get the, and in the southernmost islands of the island, Andaman Nicobar Islands, there was submergence of mangrove patches for about 1 meter, and because of permanent inundation, lot many species died. So like this, in other countries also, a major part of mangroves has been affected, and the changes are taking place very slowly because of the zonation parameters. In some areas, mangroves are coming back, but in some areas, mangrove associates are coming back. So this all depends upon the habitat factors, which we have already seen in the earlier slides. A number of factors limit the species which can thrive.
Hello, sir. Your voice is not in.
We are extremely sorry, as we have some technical problem once again. As the speaker is speaking from Andaman and Nicobar Islands, which is more than 2,000 kilometers away from our place, and it is purely due to some technical problem, we are not able to connect with him immediately. In the meantime, I can request the participants, if you are having any doubts regarding mangroves, you can raise your queries as well as you can put your queries in the chat box also, so that we can utilize that time in time. Thank you.
फिर साउंड चले गया लगता है
साउंड चले गया
I think the we got resumed the signal, it seems. Jojo, you can proceed with your presentation.
Okay, okay, sir. So as I have already told, mangrove species can range, especially in three regions. They are very specially colonizers in according to the soil conditions. And in the they are clearly distinguished three important zones of mangrove occupation, that is proximal zone, middle zone, and distal zone. Proximal zone is nothing but those areas which are very close to sea or seawater, and there the limiting factors of mangroves are very high. The plants have specialized adaptations, stilt roots, prop roots, nematophores, etc. will be well developed. And in the middle zone, it is comparatively a safe zone. Instead of the mangroves, trees are attaining maximum height in such areas. And in distal zone, that is the area towards the land, there is availability of more water, and it is towards the land fringe. Salinity is also comparatively less. The species colonize there according to the species. So distinctly we can see three distinct type of mangroves in large deltaic areas of mangroves, but it is not visible in small areas or patchy mangrove distribution is seen. Zonation, knowledge about the zonation is also very important with respect to plantation of mangroves are concerned. If you don't know much about the zonation pattern of the species, our plantation still may fail. A species which can thrive in proximal zone generally cannot come in distal zone, and vice versa also. So zonation is an important parameter which we have to take into account at the time of species selection for plantation. Mangroves, they are ecologically a distinct group of plants. Taxonomically, they are not distinct. There are many families comprising of mangroves. And mangrove species can be mostly identified with their morphological features rather than going to their floral structures and complexities. So from the initial time onwards, I have told the mangroves can be broadly divided into two, mangrove true species as well as the mangrove associates. True mangroves are those species which are exclusively confined to mangrove areas, while the mangrove associates are seen in non-mangrove areas also. Now, among the true mangroves, there are three species which are spiny. Their leaves, their stems are spiny, and this belongs to Acanthus genus. We have three species of Acanthus in the country: Acanthus ilicifolius, Acanthus ebracteatus, and Acanthus volubilis. Acanthus ilicifolius has blue flowers. Generally, blue flowers are very rare in the plant kingdom, and the white flowers are produced by another species, Brachiates, and another Acanthus volubilis is a climber species. Then there are two palm-like species in the mangrove ecosystem. One is Nipa fruticans, and another one is Phoenix pallidosum. One genus, that is Cyanomyltra, produce wrinkled fruits. So with this fruits itself, we can identify the species. And one species produce milky lactates. If we cut the leaves or bark of the plant, milky exudation will come up. So that means it is Exicaria species. If you see the root system, very extensive prop roots and stilt roots are seen in Rhizophora. In Brugiera, the stilt roots are comparatively thin, but at the same time, they have knee roots for breathing purpose. The pneumatophores for the breathing roots of genus Avicennia, Sonaracea, and Psilocarpus, they are different shapes. If the breathing roots or the pneumatophores are pencil shaped, it belongs to Avicennia group. In Sonaracea genus, the pneumatophores or the breathing roots are conical in shape. And in Psilocarpus, it is peg-like. And the Psilocarpus granatum has a very large fruit. By seeing the fruit itself, we can identify the tree. And the Heritaria littoralis has boat-shaped fruits. So from seeing the shape of the fruit also, we can identify this tree. Now, if we are going to the conservation aspect of mangroves, I have already told this is one of the most threatened ecosystems in the world. In India alone, over 40% of the mangrove area in the West Coast has been converted for agriculture and urban development. And the range of degradation of the mangroves in the global level is between 20% to 35%. Highest of any of the ecosystem types in the world. At least 35% of the area of mangrove forest has been lost in the past two decades. This exceeds the range of habitat destruction for tropical rainforest and coral reefs. These are the two other well-known threatened ecosystems. But among these three ecosystems, among these three most threatened ecosystems, mangroves are the most vulnerable ecosystem. Despite of it, this ecological and economical values, in the last two decades, global mangroves has witnessed annual loss between 0.16 and 0.39% due to rapid coastal development. So no other type of vegetation or ecosystem is that much suffered like mangroves, because they are the prime areas or the thrust areas for development. So most of the mangroves all over the world are reclaimed or cleared for industrial development, cultivation, plantation, etc. Another aspect of mangrove threat is habitat fragmentation. In most of the Southeast Asian countries, vast areas of mangroves have been reclaimed for aquaculture and paddy cultivation. The habitat is fragmented, then it leads to species extinction and further degradation. So habitat fragmentation is also another important factor which is highly threatening the global mangrove habitats, along with the patchiness, along with the habitats for industrial development, etc. Now, if we see the globally threatened mangrove species, they are also seen in the Southeast Asian countries. About 11 species of the total mangroves are in the elevated threat of extinction, that is either critically endangered or vulnerable species. As far as India is concerned, out of the 46 species of mangroves reported from the country, 9 species are of global importance because classified under the first 3 IUCN threat categories, that is critically endangered, then endangered and vulnerable. So Sonoracea griffithi, this is generally called mangrove apple. This species is locally extinct in many of the Southeast Asian countries. Its seed viability is very low, and it has been categorized under critically endangered. The species is available in Andaman Nicobar Islands in a very, very small patches. Another species, Heritaria forms, seen in Sundarbans, it has been classified under endangered category. Then Cereops decandra, that is near threatened. The area of occupancy of this species all over the world is drastically reducing. Another species is Phoenix pallidosa. This is also a near threatened species. Area of occupancy is drastically reducing. Sonoracea oveta, this is also a near threatened species. Then other species are Aegitalis rotundifolia, brown lobia tersa, and 2 species, the data are not sufficient. So they have been classified as data deficient species. So 9 species out of the 46 species of the country are under various threat categories. If you consider the whole species of the country, except Abyssinia marina and Exicaria agalocha, all other species are at varying levels of threat. The species diversity of the mangroves of the country are under constant flux due to both natural and anthropogenic forces, possibly leading to changes in their floristic composition and local extinction of some species. This shows the specificity of species towards 3 important ecological parameters of mangroves, that is soil texture, salinity and tidal amplitude. Every species has different levels of tolerance towards these 3 important parameters of mangrove ecosystem. Some species can thrive in sandy areas, where some species prefers clayey areas, and other species can come in a range of these 2. Another aspect is salinity. Some species can come in very concentrated saline areas, where some species are very sensitive to salinity. They can come only in a very dilute saline areas only. Like the tidal amplitude is also very important. The tidal inundation can be tolerated by some species, whereas in some species, tidal amplitude or tidal inundation cannot be tolerated at high level. So accordingly, species shows different tolerance levels towards these 3 important ecological factors, that is soil texture, salinity, and tidal inundation. And as I have already told regarding the species selection, we have to select the species according to these 3 parameters. If the site selected for plantation have more salinity, then we have 2 species which can tolerate high saline areas. If the selected area is sandy, then we have to go according to the species. If the tidal amplitude is high, then again we have to select those species which can tolerate high amplitude. So these 3 ecological factors are very important at the time of selection of species for mangrove plantation. So this is all about the mangroves of the country, their general characters, adaptations, diversity, species richness. At the same time, the various threats which are being faced by the mangroves, the global threats status of the country, of the mangroves of the country, and what are the species which have been categorized under IUCN categories. These species need special conservation efforts, because if we take up the species-wise mangrove plantation, these species which are under various level of threat are likely to be locally extinct. wherever we go for mangrove plantation, we generally don't go for species wise mangrove plantation. We just go for a general mangrove plantation only. We have to give much emphasis for those species which are categorized under different IUCN categories. Those 9 species which are very limited in the country has to be given much emphasis on mangrove plantation. Special conservation drives has to be taken up. The areas of these species has to be selected and demarcated and protected from anthropogenic activities. Regeneration activities has to be increased for these species so that the country will not lose its high diversity of mangrove species. As of now, 46 species reported. So this is about the mangroves, and I will show some of the rare mangrove species of the country. This is Acanthus ebrachiatus. As I have already told, belonging to the genus Acanthus, we have 3 species. These are small plants. The leaves and stems are spinescent. And 3 species have been reported from the country in which Acanthus ebrachiatus and Acanthus volubilis are comparatively rare. Acanthus ciliciforius is very frequently seen in mangrove habitat. So this particular species is Acanthus ebrachiatus. It has white flowers. Acanthus ciliciforius has blue flowers. This is the Acanthus volubilis. This is a climber and it has white flowers. Now, in the Avicennia group, this species is comparatively rare. This is Avicennia officinalis. The stem is very black in color and its flowers are little bit bigger than the common species of Avicennia marina and Avicennia alba. This is another comparatively rare species. This is Psilocarpus molucensis. It has a peg-shaped nematophores. It is very limitedly occurring in the Indian states. Another one is Brugiera parviflora. This one is also of very rare distribution. It has very thin and elongated fruits. And it generally appears in a light green foliage. So this particular species also very rare in the country. Down low, this is a shrub species. The lower surface of the leaf is copper colored or silver colored. So from the leaf itself, we can identify. So the area occurrence of this species in the country is also very less. So these are the some of the rare species of the country. As I have already told, out of the 46 species of the true mangroves of the country, 9 has been listed under various threat categories as per IUCN classification. So this is all about the mangroves. I have touched most of the aspect of the mangroves. And now it is the time for the viewers to clarify their doubts for further clarification on the points they want to discuss. So thank you once again for sharing your valuable time with me.
Thank you, Dr. Jojo Alapat, sir, for your extensive lectures and the showing of the slides of your different rare species of mangroves. So there is one question, sir, in the chat boxes.
Yes.
Okay. Why all mangroves are considered as a sacrosanct? Posted by Ravi Shankar Durairaj.
It's not clear.
Why all mangroves are considered as sacrosanct? Protected, maybe in somewhat way.
Protected in?
No, he just posted a general.
I think there is some issue over there. I'll add up on for the question. The question is about the mangroves to be considered as a sacrosanct. Not all the mangrove species are being called a sacrosanct. Few species as per the region wise. If I am not wrong, in Bengal, few species are being considered as a sacred trees. Even in Tamil Nadu, I can say that the famous Chidambaram temple, which is one of the known and famous temple, the temple tree or the stala vrucham for the temple is Exocaria. That is one of the famous mangrove. So in different places, different mangrove species are being called as sacroscand. That's what I can say.
Okay. I will add up, sir, 1 minute.
Yeah, sure.
Yes. Actually, most of these species are being socially connected with the coastal communities, especially by the fishermen communities. This particular species, Exocaria agalocha, is being considered as a sacred species in the most of the coastal areas of the country. And why some of the species has been considered as sacred? Because their social affinity with the people who are living in the coastal areas. Most of the mangrove species are associated with the fishermen communities. For example, the bark and the resin obtained from the bark of some of the mangrove species are used for fishing purposes. Okay, so like that, most of the mangrove species find one or the other utilization aspect in the communities of the people who are living in the coastal areas. So that's why, considering the social importance of the mangroves, in certain part of the country, mangroves are being worshipped or being given a special status. And that is what is happening for this particular species like Exocaria agalocha, like that. So like that, some species are so socially linked with the people of the coastal areas and that they have been considered as sacred.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
And I take pleasure in welcoming Shri Adar Sinha IAS, Director General EPTRI and Special Chief Secretary to Government of Telangana, for sparing his valuable time. He's before us, sir. I welcome you, sir. I requesting NV's EPTRI activities which is proposed these days. I'm handing over the sessions to EPTRI.
Thank you, Mr. Thank Srimati Smita IAS, Chairperson of Puducherry Pollution Control Committee, and Dr. S. Dinesh Khanna, IFS, Member Secretary of Puducherry Pollution Control Committee, and Mr. Vipin. Thank you for jointly organizing with EPTRI and NVIS for this event. I take this privilege of introducing our organization, EPTRI. EPTRI was set up in 1992 in Hyderabad as an independent society with the assistance of state government, Government of India and Swedish International Development Agency to provide technical assistance on environmental issues. EPTRI comes under Environment, Science and Technology Department, Government of Telangana. EPTRI is managed by Board of Governors. Chief Secretary, Government of Telangana is the chairman of Board of Governors. EPTRI is the chief executive of the centers at EPTRI include Environment Protection Center, Environment Research and Development Center, and Training and Capacity Building Center, which are divisions. It serves as a one-stop shop for comprehensive solutions to environmental issues and offers a wide range of services. Some of the main trust areas include expertise in carrying out EIE and SIE studies, environmental impact assessment and social impact assessment studies, expertise in dealing with segregation of waste and its management, a nodal agency in climate change adaptation and mitigation, mass propagation of RET species, biodiversity studies, and our state-of-art laboratory for testing quality of air, noise, water, wastewater, soil, etc., evaluation of ETP, STP, and CETPs, conducting professional and need-based training programs. EPTRI also welcomes students to join as interns for working in live projects. EPTRI has core strength of professionals from mental science, spatial training, engineering, geography, geology, life sciences, microbiology, biotechnology, solid-based management, etc. I take this opportunity in introducing our DG here.
In the presentation procedure, no.
Am I audible?
Yes, ma'am. You can proceed, ma'am.
Before handing over to our DG sir, I take this opportunity in introducing our DG sir, Shri Adar Sinha, our officer of the Indian Administrative Service, currently working as Special Chief Secretary to Director General EPTRA. Sir has contributed to the growth in all the departments he worked with. Mentioning views, Sir worked as Secretary to Andhra Pradesh Public Service Commission, MD to Civil Supplies Corporation, and later Dairy Development Corporation, Zonal Commissioner for Hyderabad Municipal Corporation, MD for Hyderabad Water Supply and Sewerage Board, followed by Principal Secretary, Municipal Administration and Urban Development Department, Commissioner of Collegiate and Later Meeting for Education, and also as Land Administration. Sir has visited many countries and contributed to management of elections as election observer in various states, and also compiled a book on history of intermediate education in undivided Andhra Pradesh, which is a great source book that benefits both the states, AP and Telangana. Now I request the sir to share his remarks, sir. How did you, sir?
Excuse me, sir. Your voice is not audible, sir.
Sir,
you are on mute mode, sir.
Is it audible now?
Yes, sir. Audible, sir.
Okay. So, thank you, Jyoti, for the introduction and introducing about EPTRI also. I extend my greetings to Srimati Smita R, IAS Chairperson, Puducherry Pollution Control Committee, Dr. S. Dinesh Khanna, IFS Member Secretary, PPC, C, Mr. Vipin, NVIS Coordinator, and today's expert speaker, Sri Joju P. Allapat, and participants and students, and the team from EPTRI. World International Day for the Conservation of the Mangrove Ecosystem is being celebrated on 26th July every year. And we may, Puducherry of course is close to the sea, but Telangana being a landlocked state, you may be wondering why Telangana is participating in this program. That is for the simple reason that Telangana and Andhra Pradesh, two sister states, Telugu-speaking sister states, have many things in common. And one of them is that NVIS is also doing our mangroves in the Andhra area, and there are three mangroves in three districts of Andhra Pradesh, East Godavari, Krishna and Guntur. There are mangrove forests and as a part of our study on the ecosystem of Eastern Ghats, our engagement with Andhra Pradesh government on various projects, we are also taking up the study in Andhra Pradesh state, and they are the mangroves in Andhra Pradesh are on the estuaries of Krishna and Godavari River, and Krishna and Godavari River again connects Telangana with Andhra Pradesh, apart from of course Maharashtra, and therefore, as we all know, that nature is a great connector and interconnector. And we forget all our geographical and political and other boundaries. And when we talk about nature, we don't talk in these terms, but we take a very larger view of life, of nature. In fact, global is the most common and popular terminology which is used nowadays, and rightly so. So that is one of the great lessons of nature, that it helps us to connect not only places and rivers and forests, but also people, because it is the people who have to be connected Well, in today's world, the connection between people has become slightly a question mark on various reasons. One of the reasons is the present pandemic, where people are advised to maintain social distance, which is of course something which is unavoidable in the given situation. It is not something that it can be avoided. But then we have other ways of connecting each other, and nature gives us that opportunity, that lesson. When we go into the open areas, automatically social distancing is followed. People go and look at the trees or the rivers or the landscape, and then automatically there is so much of fresh air and so much of energy flowing around that it helps to bring about the integration that is required for people to be together and yet maintain the protocol that is required in the current situation. So, keeping that in mind, I think that would be the right preface for a right background for many of you who may be wondering as to why Telangana and Puducherry, which are perhaps separated by two states, Andhra Pradesh and Tamil Nadu, are joining today on this International Day for the Conservation of the Mangrove System. And apart from that, we all need to study. It is not that what is happening today in a mangrove is something which remains unconnected to the hinterland or to the inner landlocked regions. We have seen the effect of cyclone. When the cyclone strikes the coastal areas, there is heavy rainfall even in the plains area. So it is not that the cyclone is only affecting the coastal area, but the effect of the cyclone is happening even in the mainland or in the plains area. So we need to be aware about nature. We need to be conscious of the various issues, the various importance of various natural ecosystems that are there. And on the World Environment Day, we have the ecosystem regeneration is the theme of this World Environment Day. Reimagine and recreate and recycle or reuse. So recreating things can happen even in knowledge sharing and not just in the physical world. So the importance of mangroves to mankind as a whole has already been covered by the expert speaker and by the previous speakers. But just to give an overview that they not only are important for the coastline or the shore area or the areas abutting the coastal shores, but they are also important for the inner areas. And it is this interconnection that whatever is happening on the coastal area, either directly or indirectly, also will affect the inner area. That is the issue that we need to realize. And that is why today Telangana and Puducherry Pollution Control Committee, we are all on the same platform discussing about the International Day for the Mangroves. So keeping that in mind, not only for today for the mangrove, but for various other issues that concern the present situation, where we have air pollution, where we have water pollution, where we have wastewater pollution, where we have plastic pollution. Plastic pollution has become one of the biggest menace of the society, of the economy, because without plastic, many of the latest consumer things that we have will not take place. The consumer market is booming because plastic is used mostly for wrapping, for packing, for transportation, for so many activities. But the same plastic is also causing its own problem in terms of plastic pollution and the effect for hundreds and thousands of years that one plastic shred leaves behind. So we all need to take up these issues as a part of study, as a part of awareness, as a part of knowledge sharing, because that is the first step. Unless we know that what is the solution, what is to be done does not take place. So the cause is very important, and then only the solution takes place, the effect takes place, and then we know about the effect, especially for students and practitioners on the field who are dealing with waste and waste-related issues day in and day out. So keeping all this in mind, I think we need to see that we spread our awareness. We not only learn about the issues that are posed before us in the form of such days when we have the mangrove ecosystem preservation as the theme, but we also share other issues with our friends, family members, and colleagues, so that this, because as I said, this is something which affects the whole mankind. The nature is one of the greatest connectors, and that is why today the global the global situation is so much concerned about environment and climate change and all related issues. So we all need to be aware of it, we all need to be alert to it, and we all need to be proactively involved and engaged with the various authorities, including the civil society, the NGOs, the public bodies, the public agencies, the various state players that are there, whether it is in the urban area or in the rural area. Everybody has to be part of this whole dialogue on the ecosystem, not only of mangrove, but of all other ecosystems that we are concerned with, whether it is in the coastal area or in the forests or in the plains or in the desert or in the dry areas or in the hilly regions, northeast. We have so much of diversity in India that itself helps us to understand that how nature is so diverse. In our own India, we have right from Himalayas to Kanyakumari. We have the whole map of every possible activity that affects nature, whether it is the snow-bound areas, whether it is the hilly areas, whether it is the forest areas, whether it is areas where tribal population is more. Everywhere we are all having the natural resources, both human resources, which are required to, the interplay between both is what is ultimately environment. So keeping all this in mind, I'm very happy that today we are all able to come on this common platform and take up this world, that International Day for the mangrove ecosystem, preservation and promotion and protection. And we in Telangana are able to join hands with Puducherry Pollution Control Committee in EPTRI in Telangana and PPCC in Puducherry. And I'm sure that we will be able to continue this sort of a dialogue and discussion and engagement with each other in future also. I wish you once again a very good day, and thanks for joining this program. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.
For sharing your views and emphasizing on the need for conservation of the nature and joining the event. I now request DJ sir to launch the poster.
Jyoti, please release the poster.
To share the poster.
Please go ahead.
I now request Mr. Vipin sir to share the poster, please.
few minutes, Isma. Just we are uploading it.
Jyoti, you can do the screen sharing, na?
I'm doing so.
You have it on the mail or something. Sunila was telling me. Can we?
I now request Ms. Padmashri to say a few lines about the poster.
Yeah, it has come. Okay.
Ma'am, am I audible?
Yes. It's audible, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you for giving me this opportunity. EPTRI NWIS has prepared a poster on International Day for the conservation of the system. This is to raise awareness on the importance and the conservation of the mangrove ecosystem, which is celebrated on 26th July each year. The poster depicts about the threats and services provided by the mangroves. Some of the field studies taken up by EPTRI NWIS RP, which is on ecology of Eastern Ghats, passes through coastal areas of Odisha, Andhra Pradesh, and Tamil Nadu. As a part of it, we have collected information on mangrove ecosystems in Cherayanam and other parts of AP also. Poster also focuses on top 10 mangrove forests and total mangrove cover in India. Now I request Vipin sir to propose vote of thanks.
Thank you. From Puducherry NWIS Center, we are just releasing our small booklets on International Day for the Conservation of the Mangrove Ecosystems. This is also hosted in our website, so the participants can also kindly download. Now it's the time for the vote of thanks. I thank Ministry of Environment, Forest and Climate Change, NWIS Secretariat for their immense support in conducting the awareness programs. And I take this privilege in thanking Joju P. Alapat for his elaborate presentations on mangrove conservation by sharing his field experiences on true mangroves and related species. I thank EPTRI for co-supporting this event hand in hand. And it's my privilege to thank Shri Adar Sinha AS, DG EPTRI, for attending this event and sharing the importance of the natural ecosystems and the interconnectivity of human and the natural. Sir has also rightly pointed about the plastic issues, which is immensely been a major problem since in all the states. Thank you, sir. And I thank Smita Raya, Secretary of Environment, for encouraging the NV Center in conducting such a programs for the benefit of the public. I take privilege in thanking my member secretary, Dr. S. Dinesh Kannan, IFS, for mentoring and his supports. I thank all my colleagues, friends, for the support in conducting this webinar. I thank all the participants. Thank you, sir. Thank you, one and all.
Thank you.
അന്ന് നല്ലതിൽ ക്ലാസ് ആയിരുന്നല്ലോ.
ഇലക്ട്രിക് ബിൽ ഉണ്ടാക്കുന്നുണ്ട്.
വാട്സപ്പ്.